Welcome to today's session. Post our discussion relating to composition levy, major points relating to composition levy, we have touched up and completed everything on our earlier session. In fact, there are nothing much when it comes to composition levy. A person who satisfies all those discussed 12 conditions, roughly about 12 conditions, then he would be entitled to pay taxes at a substantially lower rate. Maybe one or two questions, little important from a different count. In my view, that is also part and parcel of your erstwhile earlier discussion or an earlier level discussion. Without giving options for all those, maybe we can take it up, all those aspects or all those questions, just to move away or just to ensure all those aspects are taken care. Coming back here, we'll take up a question. GG Limited. GG Limited comes out and gives details of transactions made by them during the financial year 1920. I would not use a phrase taxable supply. Domestic supply on payment of tax rupees 45 lakhs supply exempt by notification rupees 30 lakhs Thank you. company wants to opt composition levy during 2021. Maybe a note is also given. Current year, they may not export goods or service. Just it's just additional information. Now, all that we have here is a company which is engaged, their domestic supply, their turnover relating to domestic supply, their turnover relating to supply on which they don't pay tax, all are brought in here. Yes. So the question to us is GG Limited is eligible or eligible for composition levy or not eligible for composition? In the case of GG Limited, quick. Kindly make a note, there are some conditions that are all given. Don't just like that answer it. We are asking only for 19, 20, 20, 21. We are not asking for 19, 20, the status. 20, 21, we are asking the status. Bala, you have called. You have called Bala. Okay. Quick. Others, initial views I get, which is GG Limited is ineligible. I don't agreeable to that view. GG Limited is eligible to claim or ineligible to claim. Decide based on that. What is current year they are going to do? That information is also there. So don't much break your head based on last year transaction. Last year transaction, what is relevant for us is only the turnover. Yes, I get mixed views. Some of you say no, not eligible. A few of you say yes, they are eligible. Yes. GG Limited is eligible to opt composition levy, not eligible. Sai Subramaniam, that 10% criteria, do we need to check current year when we pay tax? Or previous year. Keeping all the challenges, all the possibilities, only we brought this question. Somebody say me it is ineligible because they are dealing in export. Current year they should not do or previous year they should not do. Check. Current year, their service income should not be more than 10% of their total aggregate turnover, or previous year it should not be. From a previous year data, what we will check? Pavitra. Purva VS Nandini Kirti Shruti. All of you refrain from answering. Don't ask me questions. You are all indirectly saying. Let me repeat it. I caution you. If I don't get enough responses, my dears, I would be not showing much interest in taking up some of those questions. It would be easy for me also give a small note at the end of the session and ask you to work it by yourself. Because from the constant understanding that comes up, where many people insisted us to take questions during the session, it gives a different learning. Questions are taken up. It's an additional effort. Either it is typing out here or taking up this question here itself. Ambiga Ganapati, the limit of service, or Sai Subramaniam, the limit of service is for current year revenues or previous year revenues. The number, what is 10%, you will take the number from that. From previous year, for me, what data is relevant to take the option eligible or not? Yes. I don't know why a lot of you are all silent. I'm not getting the responses which I usually get. I leave it to you all. Okay. And I henceforth refrain myself from taking up questions. This is the, this was my final question. In none of the topic, unless you people come up, I would not take up. In once the session is over, I'll give you a small handout. The questions, you can do it by yourself, or if you want, we will take it. Now, in any case, having taken up this question, one, a decision has to be taken for current year 2021 for based on the earlier year data. Are they eligible for compensation levy during 2021? My only one number reference is, my previous year turnover should not exceed more than 150 lakhs. Assuming they are engaged in supply of goods. Of course, they are engaged in service. When it comes to current year, after opting the composition levy, their current year service turnover should not be more than what? 10% of their previous turnover or rupees 5 lakhs, whichever is higher. So coming back here, there is no restriction that previous year you should not do. See, a year which is already completed, a year which the business is done, you cannot rewrite anything. It is all done. So previous year, I would refer only one number. What is my aggregate turnover? My aggregate turnover will include domestic, taxable supply, exempted supply, zero rated supply, non-taxable supply, plus all other informations. So when we add through all those numbers, it would be my domestic supply would be included, followed by exempted supply 30 lakhs would be included, export of goods would be included, export of service would be included. Normally in aggregate turnover, interest income will also be included. Normally in aggregate turnover, interest income also will be included. Because, let me repeat, because there is a proviso to section 10, at the fag end, comes out and specifically says that interest will not form part of the aggregate turnover for the purpose of this section. Because of that reason, let me come back here. The interest income will not be added. So it will be a simple number of 45 lakhs plus 30 lakhs plus 40 lakhs plus 25 lakhs. Working up somewhere 85 lakhs, 90, 100, 145 lakhs. If I'm not wrong, you should get 60, 70, 130. We are exceeding the limit. Can somebody help me out? What is your number? 140 lakhs. Okay, 140 lakhs. Hope you all, if you add that numbers, excluding interest, let me repeat, excluding interest. So because 140 lakhs is less than 150 lakhs, for the purpose of this computation, GG Limited would be eligible for composition levy. What other condition comes in? Once GG Limited in the year 2021 becomes eligible for composition levy, they should not do an interstate supply. If they do a service income, that service income should be less than 10% of the total. Come on, for applicability, there are two numbers. Applicability of composition levy, calculating tax on composition levy, or calculating, are they still eligible for it? When it comes to calculating your tax and are they still eligible in the current year, only for that you have an additional condition. This is basic conditions. My prima facie condition, previous year turnover less than 150 lakhs. So they are eligible for current year. Current year, they should not export goods. They should not export services. They should do supply only within the state. Their service income can be maximum of 10% of their previous year aggregate turnover. So that is how it has to be understood. Done? True? Yes. So wherever, whomever is being slipped, make yourself comfortable. Yes, I'll get into my next today's topic of discussion. Moving from here, I originally had some intentions to discuss some questions. Now let's move into topic. Make yourself comfortable on certain other questions that might be tested on composition levy on different grounds. We have a lot more combinations. All those combinations are possible. Refer to your material or any of those other standards for better understanding on problems. Vaishnavi has raised a question. If question is silent about the note on current year data, if in case the question is silent about the note on current year data, means I don't understand. What do you mean by note on current year data? Even if that note is not given, next year they will not do. If the note is not given, still they would be eligible. You cannot say they are not eligible. That is only last year turnover. That cannot be a reason for current year. Time of supply. As far as time of supply is concerned, time of supply of goods, time of supply of services. When we carefully recollect section 9 of CGST or SGST Act or section 5 of IGST Act, both sections would have mentioned very clearly all intrastate supply or interstate supply, as the case may be, is leviable to tax except alcoholic liquor for human consumption and one goods that is covered under PET. One good covered under the next section, which is going to be petroleum product. The rate of tax will be maximum so much as per the section, 20% in case of CGST, SGST 20%, and IGST 40%, 40. Value will be determined as per section 15, that will also be there. And the tax shall be paid, determined and paid as per section 12 and 13 of CGST Act. In both cases, it will be referred as CGST Act. A time of supply is determined as per Section 12 and Section 13 of CGST Act. Coming back here, the need to determine time of supply when someone is liable to pay tax. At what point in time someone is liable to pay tax? No doubt, a person is liable to pay tax. A person is liable to pay tax at the time in which he is liable to pay tax. My liability to pay tax to the government. No doubt, when a person is engaged in supply, he is liable to pay tax. But when he has to pay that tax to government, we are discussing a relationship between a supplier and a government. A supplier who sell a goods, a supplier who provide us services. When he has to pay tax to government, when we get into that question, yes, no doubt, that question gets its answer based on the discussion relating to Section 12 for time of supply of goods and Section 13 for time of supply of services. Coming back here, Section 12, time of supply of goods is concerned. Section 12 has 6 subsections and each subsection is important by itself. Section 12 comes out and highlights that the time of supply of goods would be broadly categorized, into 5 different types. What are those 5 different types? It has been broadly categorized into 5 different types. What are those 5 different types? When we get into that discussion, time of supply of goods, general. Time of supply of goods in case of reverse charge transactions. Time of supply of goods in case of additional consideration, time of supply of goods in case of your vouchers and other situation. About 5 different situations are discussed as part of the respective provision. At a very macro level, we can have a discussion something like this, where time of supply. The term time of supply can be broadly categorized. Into 2 types. A time of supply of goods and a time of supply of service. When it comes to time of supply of goods, general, time of supply of goods, reverse charge mechanism, time of supply of goods, your voucher, time of supply of goods, additional consideration, time of supply of goods, thus. Section 12, subsection 2. Well, 3. Well, 4. Do I need to remember subsection? In exams, subsection do matter at final level. That to this topic, all are independent decisions. So your remembrance of subsection becomes important. When it comes to, similarly, on the note relating to services, 13.2, time of supply of service, general, reverse charge, voucher. Similarly, almost same alignment of the section, not a great difference. In fact, the content wise also same. Some of the laws, when are all being drafted, government is very keen. They don't want you to make you confuse a lot more. Very clear. Wherever, to the extent possible, they come up with the same understanding. To the extent wherever they can come and support you, to the extent wherever they can help you out in terms of their understanding, they always come up with the same analogy, same model, everything is same. This is your broader sketch. In fact, for the next 1 hour or so, we are going to discuss only about a discussion only about time of supply of goods and time of supply of service. Post that, we will discuss another section called as change in rate of tax, and that would lead us to the conclusion relating to time of supply of goods and services. Time of supply of goods. Yes. So broadly, in a nutshell, that's all. So five broader classification: general, reverse charge, voucher, additional consideration, others, both for goods and services, covered by section 12, time of supply of goods, 13, time of supply of service. Why it is important? Why time of supply is being given so much weightage? What makes time of supply something so special? In case if you're going to appreciate or want to know about that, then take care of the first word. Liability to pay tax shall arise at the time of supply. When I have to pay tax to government, at what moment I have to pay tax to government, that solely rise on the time of supply. That solely rise. If I engage in a supply, for this supply, every supply, every transaction, for this supply, when I have to pay tax to government, decided based on time of supply. So I might would have engaged in a transaction very early, for which, for various reasons, money can come only now. Again, my liability to pay tax is on that day or today. I would have done and completed an audit maybe 6 months before. For various reasons, it got extended, it was billed now only. Is my time of supply is that day or today? Decision has to be taken. I would have supplied goods. When we supplied goods, we were not even in consensus, will we be able to sell it in the market or not? Is my time of supply is that day or today? Sometime there would be a possibility I need to supply goods or services continuously, periodically. I would not be able to even stop my supply of goods, stop my supply of services. It has to be continuously supplied. So in case of continuous supply of goods, continuous supply of services, I will explore it, supply it. I'll explore it, supply it. Take in case of some of those gases that are explored from the sea and sent through pipes to various companies. In Andhra Pradesh, Kakinada, we have the live example where Reliance would explore this natural gas, extract it from the sea, based on the exploration rights which is given to Reliance through pipeline, which has been laid down for about 45 kilometers. Through that pipeline, the natural gas will be supplied to NFCL, Nagarjuna Fertilizers Chemical Limited. NFCL will get it, process it, and make their products. Here, what is my liability to parents? At the moment when I've been exploded, or when the gas is in the pipeline, or when the point in which it is consumed. And at no point in time I cannot stop this. Though it's being a gas, I cannot stop it. It has to be explored, supplied, explored, supplied, explored, supplied. We have some periodical cutoffs. Every month we will draw a statement. In my end, I would say how much I have pumped. In his end, he will say how much he has received. Based on his end receipt, we will calculate and pay periodically. However, we will work what is the reason for that gap, and then many things. Maybe, thank God, we don't have electricity and all brought into GST. If electricity and all is brought into GST, we will have a lot more challenges. What will be uplinked as a onload for NLC will be completely different from what has been received by Karnataka Electricity Board when they have been received at the other end. So electricity, though it is a goods, it is being exempted by government. So there are possibilities for continuous supply of goods, continuous supply of services. In case of continuous supply of goods or continuous supply of services, or even normally, when I have to pay tax. If you ask the question when, answer would come from section 12 in case of goods and 13 in case of services. When it comes to goods, section 12 to discuss about a general scenario. Sir, what do we mean by general scenario? Let me repeat it. All headings are heading name given by us. Heading names, owner of the heading name is Mr. Ganesh Prabhu, not the law. Law straight away starts with respective section. So, in case if you refer a heading, you remember a heading, it's for a remembrance understanding we keep like this. I have to remember so many information. So, how I can remember it very quickly for those purposes. Because this section is a generic section, it is not applicable to others, like others are all specific section, we give a name called as general. Don't search somewhere and come up and say to us, I never saw the word general at all. I never saw this subheading at all. All headings, I'll give you a universal interpretation principle. All headings wherever referred by me are only meant for references. Positions has to be taken only based on the content of the section. Time of supply of goods. Time of supply of goods in a normal case, regular case, other than reverse charge case, will generally be date of issue of invoice by the supplier. Date of issue of invoice by the supplier would be time of supply. Or the last day within which invoice required to be issued. Last day on which such invoice is required to be issued under section 31. What is this section 31? Later, when we go to the part B discussion, we will learn. For the moment, understand tax invoice. Section 31 talks about tax invoice. In houses itself, 7 subsections. 31.1 first subsection comes out and says when it comes to goods, at the time of removal of goods, invoice has to be raised. Or in case goods are assembled or sent in CKD, SKD condition, completely knocked down condition, semi knocked down condition, or sometimes goods are assembled at the site of the respective person. At that time, goods will not be removed, goods will be made available. Second word. Invoice has to be raised at the time of removal of goods. Normal, 95% of the goods will be removed from one location. At the time of removal, yes, that becomes your time of supply. That day you have to raise invoice. In other words, whenever I remove goods, I have to raise invoice. There would be exceptional circumstance where I have to remove the goods from my factory, go to another person's location, assemble the goods in his location and give him the goods. He will consider that I have supplied the goods only when it is made available to him. At that time, the day in which it is made available, that would be treated as last day on which invoice has to be issued. So the last day on which invoice to be issued is date of removal or the day in which goods are made available based on the facts of the case. Generally, date of removal. Exceptionally, day in which it is made available. That is the last day to raise invoice. Sir, before removal of goods itself, we have raised invoice, sir. No botheration. Date of invoice will become your, will be considered. There are challenges, but though goods are removed, people will not issue invoice. Only for them, the last day on which such invoice issued, that would be a rider clause. Invoice has to be issued within last day. So that is just to ensure invoice is issued that day or day in which the supplier receives payment. Of these 2 days, whichever is earlier is going to be our time of supply of goods. Time of supply of goods in a general case will be date of invoice or date of receipt of payment. Of these 2, whichever is earlier. However, invoice has to be issued within the time prescribed, statutory time limit prescribed. What is the statutory time limit prescribed? I should go back to section 31. Section 31 would come out and say, in case of goods, invoice has to be issued minimum at the time of removal of goods. In case goods need to be made available, that kind of goods, then on the day in which it is made available, on that day invoice should be issued. So before this happening, on the day of happening, invoice has to be issued. Sir, in case if invoice is not issued, what will happen? That day will be considered as your equivalent to date of invoice. Your date of invoice will not be considered. That day, last day on which invoice has to be issued, that day will be considered. Like, correlate this with service. When it comes to service, you have a number of days time limit. Date of issue of invoice for service or 30 days from completion of service. If in case that invoice is not issued within that 30 days, let me repeat. In case if that invoice is not issued within that 30 days, automatically the time limit will go back and sit back to your statutory date, last date to issue invoices. In the same fashion, here also you will have, it will go back and sit with the statutory time limit. Among these 2 days, which is going to be my earliest day, that would become our time of supply. Coming back here, this discussion would be applicable only in general cases. Coming back here, in case of all those reverse charge category, before that, in case of advance, this we would have known. In case of advance receipt, there is a small exemption for goods. Any person who has received an advance for supply of goods, any supplier of goods who has received advance, he is exempted from payment of tax at the time of receipt of advance. An exemption notification came way back during November 2017 and gave an option that gave an option originally gave an option that you can pay in advance all that and all. Afterwards became little mandatory that it would be exempting all those advance receipts. In other words, in nutshell, today if I receive an advance for goods, I have an option or I've been exempted from payment of tax. This exemption is applicable only for goods. Exemption is very clear. Do I need to remember this notification number? Very carefully, yes. 66/2017 has to be remembered. So, though section says date of issue of invoice or the last day to issue invoice, that day, or date of receipt of payment of this two, whichever is earlier, technically after, when you read along with that section this exemption notification, you can now safely conclude time of supply of goods generally is going to be the day in which invoice is going to be raised, or the last day to issue invoice as per section 31 is going to come. That day would become the time of supply. So the advance payment received lost its importance after this exemption. In fact, that is also the need request of the complete industry relating to goods. They sent, we are not used to this. We will have a very large hit on our working capital. It would not be possible for us to comply with it. All these submissions was made and government is gracious enough to grant an exemption. Moving forward, getting into a discussion on time of supply of goods in case of reverse charge. Time of supply of goods in case of reverse charge is concerned. I'm sure all of us are aware. About 7 items are covered under reverse charge category. Could be cashew nut, could be BD leaf, could be used goods, scrap, cars from government, or could be lottery ticket, could be PSLC certificate, or a silk yarn procured from a manufacturer of it. These goods received by a person, registered person, then the respective recipient is liable to pay tax, no doubt. When? Either on the date of receipt of goods or on the day in which he makes payment, add one word there, to supplier. Payment to supplier. Date of payment to supplier. Supplier is going to be somebody, I am a recipient, I just pay him some money for supply. Date of receipt of goods, date of payment to supplier, or a date immediately following 30 days from date of invoice. A date immediately following 30 days from date of invoice issued by the supplier. Supplier only will issue invoice. 30 days from date of invoice by the supplier, technically 31st day. 30 days from the date of invoice. One day you will come know that day. This is when supplier has supplied the goods. Supplier has also sent you an invoice. Invoice is in your hand, but goods is not received within 30 days. Inner understanding, from Leh Ladakh to down south Kanyakumari, maximum travel time for a lorry is 24 days. We have statistics. Based on that logic only, government comes up with this proposal. At whatever stretch of imagination, leave except the COVID times, testing times, but for these exceptional discussions, let me repeat, exceptional transaction where force majeure is being invoked, considered as a god of act. Considered as an act of God, not god of act, act of God. So point to be noted for us is these are all exceptional discussion that may not form part of this regular discussion. Regularly, if goods moves, another 3 days, 4 days, 7 days, 9 days. Sir, my goods has to come from Guwahati, sir. Assam Guwahati. From there to Chennai itself is 17 days maximum. Okay. So, goods will definitely come within 30 days. In case if goods does not come, time of supply will be 31st day. 31st day will be time of supply. You put 3 days. Receipt of goods, date of payment, and 31st day. That is date immediately following 30 days from date of invoice. Of these three, whichever is earlier. Let me repeat. Again, here also a notable point. Of these three, whichever is earlier is going to be your time of supply when it comes to reverse charges concern. So when it comes to reverse charges concern, of the three different days, the day in which recipient makes payment to supplier, select that date. The day in which recipient receives the goods, prepares a GRN, prepares a MRN, material receipt note, goods receipt note, that date. Or definitely that agriculturist or supplier, somebody would have raised one document, invoice. From that document, 30 days later, a date immediately following 30 days from that document. Of these three, whichever is earlier. Earlier will be your time of supply of goods in case of reverse charge. Again, an additional point, generally either for general discussion or for your reverse charge discussion, for both together, when it comes to payment, either you receive the payment or you make the payment. General discussion, this is payment. Always there is a possibility that there would be 2 days. Day in which entry is made in books, day in which actually received or actually paid. Your bank account is debited or credited, as the case may be. If you are going to receive money, then it is credited. If you are going to pay money, then it is going to be debit. No, no, sir, we have OD account. No. We will speak from current account perspective. We will not now discuss BRS here. Current account perspective. Bank account, current account I have. Okay. I am a company who is into the principle of we will not borrow at all. So, a company like that with that principles. A company like that would come out and say, yes. Points for our discussion is, in case of these debit notes or credit note, as the case may be, not debit note, debits or credits, as the case may be, in the current account. Day in which money is credited into the account, I will have 1 day. However, I will pass an entry in the books, maybe 2 days earlier, same day, 2 days later, all is possible. If I booked in my books earlier and money comes later, if I book in my books earlier and money is being paid later, which should be considered? Government said nothing doing of these two, whichever is earlier. You account it in the fashion you want. Gone are those days. Today, people all see the bank statement and account it. So technically, there is no differences we are getting. But in a real accounts, when accounts is maintained on a day-to-day basis, where you have a complete movement of records through real-time transaction, definitely there will be a lead date. Because of a very simple reason, today you will make an entry in your books, tomorrow only check will be issued to your customer, or at least 2 days, 3 days later only it will be paid. Generally, in a genuine accounts, there will be a gap of 2-3 days. Thanks to RTGS, thanks to NEFT, thanks to automation, today in some of those ERP where we have this facility, a payment is being keyed, tagged with the respective payment schedule, approvals are done. Once the maker, checker and the approver gives the necessary approvals, automatic NEFT happens. Automatic. Everything is automatic. Very interesting to see that. Once we say pay, it will go to the bank side, given the necessary, codings. If there is a CAPTCHA needed or if anything else, external data needed, that alone will be shown. That need to be typed in. Again, user ID, password, all prefixed, which is again, that will be passed through, and then the payment would automatically. So in today's environment, again, because of the automation, NEFT, RTGS, these facility, date of payment and the day in which bank is debited, both are same. Date of credit and the day in which entry is made, both are same. If it is both are same, we don't have a discussion to make. If in case both are different, entry made on day one, month one, day one, but money received in the bank account only on day three, month one. How that is possible? Very simple. The moment I receive a check, I make an entry. But next day only I can put it into the bank. The third day only it will get cleared. So there is a float day involved in it. Day three. So my date of receipt of payment is day one or day three? Day one. The day of this two, whichever is earlier. So that is how it has to be decided when it comes to your, be it receipt of payment or date of receipt of payment or receipt. Getting back into voucher, one small point, be it voucher, be it additional consideration, be it others category, all three among goods and services would be a common discussion. No differences at all. At least in general and reverse charge, we have a small variation to discuss between goods and services. When it comes to your voucher, or it is going to be your additional consideration or reverse charge, the discussions are intact, the discussions are common, no change at all. Coming back here, date of issue of voucher, or I'll rephrase in this way. There would be possibilities that today organization do business through voucher. What do we mean by voucher? As we all know, voucher is considered as a part of consideration. Sometime for certain supply, it is accepted as a consideration. Sometime for certain supply, it is considered as a part of consideration. Don't link voucher with your meal passes of Sodexo. Sodexo meal passes are a little different. It is equated with money itself. I do understand it's also voucher. But we are talking of voucher from a different perspective. Sodexo meal passes operate on a different perspective. The voucher that we discuss here is coined for a particular organization. It is that organization's voucher. It could be as simple as that Lifestyle comes up with a Lifestyle voucher. Very interesting to note, across India, in its all 50 plus stores of Lifestyle, it is allowed to be redeemed. But you cannot go to a Shopper Stop and redeem a Lifestyle voucher. In Shopper Stop, you are allowed to redeem a Shopper Stop voucher. So in case of all those vouchers, at the time of issue of voucher, they never brought any restriction as to what goods to be supplied. which means supply is not identified at the time of voucher. When supply is not identified at the time of voucher, then date of redemption of voucher is going to be your time of supply. In case supply is identified at the time of voucher, then the date of issue of voucher. So how that distinction is possible? From my shop, using this voucher, you are freely allowed to buy any kind of product. Supply not identified. From my shop, using this voucher, you are allowed to buy only garments. Supply is identified. A supply identified, a supply not identified, only based on these aspects. There are no other aspects for supply to be identified or supply not to be identified. So coming back here, this discussion is a common discussion, be it services, be it goods, verbatim same. If supply identified, supply is identified. Date of issue of voucher is time of supply. Supply is not identified. Date of redemption of voucher is going to be time of supply, which means when I give the voucher, I have to pay tax if supply is identified. When I sell the voucher, my customer will come and redeem. Sir, that and all will take 3 months. Third month only, when he redeems, no. At that time only, I'll pay tax to go. Hope now you can link the topic in a very, very, very great way. Your real issues of payment of tax. Today, you will sell 10,000 rupees voucher. But today, you will not pay tax. And it is going to be. Often, one question will come to us. Sir, if it is not at all redeemed, what will happen? There are cases. Sometimes, for some reasons, people will give us vouchers to the extent we will remember and redeem. Sometimes we'll put it in the bag, it will be there. And 3 months once only, the bag will be cleaned. At that time, when we see, redeemed, missed the date. There are cases where we go, request, write a mail, talk to the customer care people, ensure it has been, something has been retrieved. There are cases where they accept, they're told, 20% we will reduce, balance only we will give. I said, okay. For me, instead of 5,000 going doom, you give me back at least 4,000. That's okay for me. For him, he gets an additional consideration. It's okay. Core discussion for us. When the 10,000 rupee voucher is sold, they will not pay GST. When the 10,000 rupee voucher is going to be redeemed, only then they will pay GST. As supply is not identified. So, for those purposes, yes, time of supply of voucher gains its money. Followed by, in case of additional consideration. What do we mean by additional consideration? Apart from the original value of supply, apart from your original value of supply, which we have agreed for, pay me 10,000, pay me 6,000. Pay me 15,000, pay me 20,000, some numbers which we have agreed for. Because of something happens, largely a contingent event. Let me repeat. Sir, what do you mean by a contingent event? Whether it happened, it would not happen, we are not sure on the time of supply. Recollect your FR word called as contingent liability. Okay. Borrow that word contingent over here. I make a credit sale with a condition that the other party has to make me payment within 30 days. Failing which, I have a condition, terms and condition. Failing which, I will charge him interest at the rate of 2% on the bill value. So the point to be noted down here is, I supplied goods to him. He has to make me payment within 30 days. He made me payment on 28th day. I'm happy about that. 28th day payment is received. Done. Close it. Next time I supplied goods, he received me. He sent me payment on 30th day. Okay, done. Third time I supplied goods and he has given me payment only on the 40th day. As per our contract or as per our supply invoice itself, he is liable to pay an interest of 2% for the 10 days. I collect the 2%. Now my question here is, on the day one when I supplied the goods, am I aware of this interest will come or I am not aware? When we get into that situation, I was not aware. It's a contingent event. How it is going to happen, based on that only I can react. Because he has not made payment within the time prescribed, he is liable for an interest, he is liable for a late fee, he is liable for a penalty. In those circumstances, he gives me interest. That interest is liable for GST. He gives me a late fee. That late fee is liable for GST. He gives me a penalty. That penalty is liable for GST. Now a doubt came. It is on the date of issue of invoice I am liable. On the date on receipt of that I am liable. Time of supply comes out and says date of receipt. Be it interest, be it late fee, be it penalty. Because all these additional considerations are generally contingent in nature. Then they will come or not, we don't know. Sometimes, many times, based on the business relationships, it will be written off. So today you are not sure. Today you will write, every business is making payments delayed only. Wherever the bill has to be paid in 30 days, they are paying in 60 days. Wherever the bill has to be paid in 60 days, they are paying in 90 days. Wherever the bill has to be paid in 90 days, they are paying in another 20, 30 days later. So we can't press no one, but a contingent activity which results in an additional revenue that will be liable to GST, no doubt, on the day in which it is received and not the day in which it is invoiced or billed. It is the day in which it is received, on that day they are liable to GST in case of additional uncertainty. Getting into our last discussion, time of supply in case of others or in wherever it cannot be determined. How it cannot be determined? If it is general, regularly he issue invoice, they will go to general. If it is a reverse charge transaction, it would be covered by reverse charge. If he sells voucher, it would be covered by voucher. If he gets some extra money at a later point in time, then additional consideration will cover. How others would be possible? One model, fraudulent transactions, unethical transactions, transactions not recorded in the books of accounts. Are there possibilities? Yes, very much possibilities. There are organizations who made tons and tons of hand sanitizers and not recorded in the books itself. As per the books record, when we go and see, that day his factory is in lockdown, but he would have made hand sanitizers. I'm talking of the first phase of lockdown. Made and sold it. Not recorded at all, but from the intelligence information of the department, based on some cross verification, based on few statements taken on oath by few people who are involved in these transactions, and based on few other transporters' statements, government fixes a liability on another person, pointed out, come on, don't bluff us. You have made 10,000 hand sanitizers and sold in the market. Your transporter says he has taken. Your retail vendor says he has procured from you and sold. Your accounts person says, yes, I have received certain payments for these purposes. Few sample records available in your factory says that something has happened. Your electricity consumption says that you have run your factory on that. So all these are all collaborative evidences. Now you open up. This is how the government will fix a case with an assessee who has completed, who has did a fraud. In those circumstances, date on which periodical returns filed. Okay, date on which if they have filed periodical return, I would not say even that way. The date on which periodical return to be filed. Okay. It's not even filed, to be filed. The due date, we can call in that week, that day. Or he would accept and pay the tax. Date on which tax paid. Let me repeat it. Don't think it as date on which periodical return filed. How a fraudster will file a return. No. The due date on which return to be filed. That day would be treated as time of supply. Sir, all this happened during April. So April return, what is your due date? Next month, 24th, okay, 24th May 2020 is your time of supply. Government fix. How? Date on which periodical return to be filed. Add that one word there, to be filed. Or date on which he himself agrees, yes, sorry, with curiosity, sorry, out of curiosity, I did this unethical transaction. Pardon me once, so I will pay the taxes, whatever is there. So the day in which he paid tax. I am not saying whichever is earlier and all. Either this date or that date. Some date would be fixed. This would be applicable only for fraudulent transactions, others category. Okay, others category. When 12-2, 12-3, 12-4, 12-6 is not applicable. More specifically, 12-2, 12-3, 12-4. If this 3 not applicable, 12-5 comes out and says it would be the due date of filing return or date of payment of tax as it is a fraudulent transaction. This sums up a complete discussion on time of supply of goods. Moving forward towards time of supply of services. As far as time of supply of services is concerned, as we earlier discussed, sir, what is going to be the change here? No great change. Let me repeat, absolutely no great change. Same 5-point test. Time of supply of goods general. Time of supply of service general. Time of supply of service reverse charge. Time of supply of service voucher. Time of supply of service additional consideration. Time of supply of service others. Same five broader discussions. Similarly, coming back over here. Now, when it comes to your services concern, general entry. In case of services, there is a restriction under section 31 that services invoices has to be issued within 30 days from date of completion of service. There is a restriction. After completing a service, invoice has to be issued within 30 days. In case of banking company, in case of an insurance company, the 30 days time limit is extended to 45 days. That is to say, if I completed a service yesterday of drafting a appeal related document and I have a billable event for drafting of appeals from yesterday when we had a consensus with our services that this is the reply, you go and submit, Manisha. From yesterday, within next 30 days, I have to raise a bill for those transactions. A bank who has given a loan for somebody and collects a processing charges, from the day in which it granted the loan, within 45 days, they have to raise invoice. This is a statutory time limit within which invoice need to be issued. Like how you had a statutory time limit for goods removal or making it available. Statutory time limit for services is invoice has to be issued. Invoice has to be issued within 30 days from date of completion of service in case of all services and 45 days in case of banking and financial services. If I'm unable to issue the invoice within the time prescribed, what would happen? Nothing would happen. If invoices is not issued within the time prescribed, date of completion of service would be treated as your comparison. See, in the first situation, if invoice is issued within the time prescribed, then the comparison is between date of invoice and date of receipt of payment by the supplier. In case if invoice is not issued within the time prescribed, then it is going to be date of completion of service or date of receipt of payment of this two, whichever is earlier. So, ideal situation is raising an invoice within the time prescribed, failing which my zero date starts from date of completion of service. At least government gives a window of 30 days and 45 days in certain transactions. Within that window of 30 days, if an invoice is raised, they can take advantage of it. In case if they don't raise the invoice, date of completion of service would be treated as time of supply. Or of course, date of before completing service, if I receive a payment, then the date of payment, no change in that. That is how it has to be decided. Followed by, if in case the above said both the cases does not apply, but the recipient has recorded the transaction in his books of accounts, invoice is not issued within the time prescribed, whether a particular service itself has been done by the supplier is not recorded, neither the payment is recorded, if the above two situations is not applicable. What could be above two situation? A supplier supplied service, but he has not recorded in his books of accounts. Very interesting note. The recipient of the service has recorded in his books of accounts. Mr. A, an individual, supplied a construction service to Mr. B, another individual. Mr. A is a construction engineer. He engaged in this activity. Mr. B is an individual. That individual paid some 5 lakhs for some alterations. All that alteration work happened during the COVID times. And Mr. A, because Mr. B is an individual, because Mr. B is not going to claim any deduction, because Mr. B has gave the payment in cash, Mr. A has silently not recorded that in his books of accounts. Time passed by. For some reason, we don't know what reason, Mr. B is targeted by the GST department. For some reason, Mr. B in his books of account told, paid to Mr. A rupees 5 lakhs in cash. Enough evidence to whom? Respective department. They would come out and say, on the month of April 2020, rupees 5 lakhs was paid by Mr. B to you. Have you raised invoice? This fellow will go and search. Have I raised invoice within the time prescribed number under 31(2)? No. Have you recorded the transaction on the date of completion of service at least? Within 30 days, because you have not raised invoice, have you recorded the transaction? Answer is what? No. Then the day in which the other party, that is B, has recorded the transaction, that day would become time of supply, a unique transaction. My pet metaphor is this metaphor. A few of you would have listened to me at an earlier level. This metaphor only I would have used. Good producer, bad actor, but that actor acts good. Okay. In the screen, his presence is great. In the screen, that 70 mm, he will ensure he captures everybody. A very good actor, no doubt about it. When it comes to acting, he is good. But when it comes to accounting, disclosures, all that, he is bad. So I would use a metaphor as bad actor. A very good producer, down-to-earth producer. A producer like that has to be cherished in that industry. Okay. He said, we will wait for you until whatever time you take, we will wait. For us, money is next. We have a passion, we have an interest to do film, so we are doing it. That side, which is going to be a good producer. Because he is a bad actor, the acting professional fee was fixed, 20 crore. The bad actor told, give me 10 crores in banking channel, give me another 10 crores in outside the banking channel. Outside the banking channel means not recorded in the books of accounts. So anything which is through the banking channel only will be recorded in the books of accounts. Good producer, not interested in all this. He is always aiming only for an ethical wealth. But times are like this. What this good producer did is gave 10 crores through the banking channel, another 10 crores outside the banking channel. Because he is a good producer, he wrote everything in a notebook. Whenever a film is about to be released, generally raids happen in all the production houses. It is very common that two people who don't have the capacity to do. Somebody is doing a 250 crore project, but that fellow is not even worth the 25 crores. Or his past records from the income tax department, from the GST department, is very weak. Then department will target them. It's practice. It's throughout India, this is a practice. It's not only in Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu. Everywhere this is. You have not... We want to know how you got this money, how you are doing it, who gave you money. There are lot and lot of restrictions. Have you complied with all? It's sparking all that discussion. If the books of the producer is caught, where it is cleverly written, then no doubt the bad actor would have not issued invoice. The bad actor, after completing service, he would have not paid a tax for the balance 10 crores. First 10 crores he paid. Balance 10 crores. Today, government will come and ask, there is a balance 10 crore outside the banking channel. kindly, kindly pay tax for that also. When tax is going to be accounted for that also, exactly matter would end there. Date on which recipient shows in his books of accounts. The producer, he is the recipient, supplier is the actor. The producer has recorded the transaction on such and such date. That day would become your time of supply. A third situation, exceptional situation, rare and the rarest situation. Don't get carried away by that situation. Normally, 99% of transactions would happen only between 1 and 2. In fact, among them itself, 95% within the 30 days, within 45 days, everyone will raise bill. Default. Because people are doing not from yesterday to today. From 2011, they are doing like that only. From 2011, from that day onwards, they are doing like this only. So there is, everybody know. Once I complete service, within 30 days, I have to raise bill. Because this provision is a copy paste from erstwhile point of taxation. So everyone know. What is special about it is in case somebody does some fraud, one side fraud, not unilateral fraud, not bilateral fraud. Sir, what do you mean by bilateral fraud? Bad producer, bad actor. Both will hide. Then department will come, identify that, takes you to others category. This is unilateral fraud. Unilateral fraud means good producer, bad actor. Okay. So unilateral fraud or bilateral fraud, your wish. End of the day, you don't get an exemption like what we have in goods. When it comes to goods, if I receive an advance payment, I am exempted from payment of taxes for advances. Whereas when it comes to your 13(2), this specific section, when I receive an advance, no doubt I am liable to pay tax on the advances. Because advances are liable to tax, a small concession is given by the government. If such advance amount is, if the advance amount does not exceed rupees 1000, if the advance amount does not exceed rupees 1000, time of supply of goods or services will be either the date of issue of invoice or date of advance payment at the option of the supplier. At the option of the supplier, either the day in which he receives the excess payment up to rupees 1000 or the date of issue of next invoice, whatever can be time of supply, as long as the money received is in excess up to rupees 1000. There is a service bill which need to be paid by you, your own postpaid mobile phone bill. The postpaid utility bill says 1860 rupees. You have a 2000 rupee note to you, you go and give. The respective person over there in the cash counter says, we don't have enough change to return back to you. You say, credit my account to 2000. Technically, look from a telecom company perspective. Telecom company billed you only for 1840. Whereas you paid 2000, there is an excess of 160 rupees. This excess of 160 rupees, what telecom company can do? Two options. Pay tax on the day in which they have received the excess. Option one. Option two. Pay tax when this 140 rupees is technically adjusted in the next bill. Pay tax in the next bill. Majority of the company will do the option two only. They will pay tax only in the next bill. Because it's a cyclical adjustment. Sir, bill is only 1840 rupees, but somebody who made a payment has made a payment of 5000 rupees. Because they're going to go out of town, they're going to travel to foreign country, they don't want their connection to be cut or surrendered. So what they did is they paid an upfront payment with a letter stating that we our usages might be reduced, but our expectations next 6 months until we go to US and come back, our connections will be mean, our utility bills will be like this only, we believe. And they made an upfront payment of 5,000 rupees. This provision is not applicable. 5,000 minus 1,840 when we reduce. Balance 3,140 rupees. On this 3,140 rupees, the day in which it is collected, on that day they are liable to pay. The day in which it is collected. Why, sir? Excess of 1,000. That is a special discussion. In my view, this is a topic more relevant for earlier level than your level. But just be aware that there is a provision limits. That would sum up a complete discussion on a general category. A general category of services. And takes us to the next discussion called as time of supply of service in case of reverse charge. I am sure all of you will agree with me, more than 20 services we have reverse charge services where the recipient is liable to pay tax when 2 dates. In goods we had 3 dates, here only 2 dates. Date of payment made to the supplier. Hope you are able to appreciate this. Payment to supplier that day. Or one small change. Date immediately following 60 days from date of invoice issued by supplier. There 30 days we took, here 60 days. Government gives another 30 days time. 60 days is considered. Day in which I paid to my supplier or 61st day from date of invoice by supplier. Of these two, whichever is earlier is going to be time of supply of service in case of reverse charge. So in case of reverse charge, 61st day from invoice by supplier or date of payment to supplier of these two, whichever is earlier. So, yes. So that would simply sum up the 13. Do I have anything extra here, sir? Yes. There is a proviso to 13.3 which comes out and discuss in case of associated enterprise. Some of you can ask me, what is associated enterprise? Recollect your income tax section 92 capital A. I'm not sure. Have you read it now till now? Definitely you will read it as part of your final discussion where a transfer pricing is involved in it, where you have the CUP method, transaction net margin, or various other the today's jargon of be it BEPS or it is going to be your safe harbor rules or whatever be it, that the complete discussion on transfer pricing on that the first section 92 capital A. Of course 91 talks about tax credits others, but 92 capital A will discuss about associated enterprise. When two organizations will be called as associated enterprise, a holding companies, subsidiary company. Associated enterprise. Common directors, associated enterprise. A company procures 90% of material from one more company, associated enterprise. Holding company, subsidiary company, associated enterprise. Both the companies have been held by a common parent, associated enterprise. Both the company hold a common subsidiary undertaking, associated. So you'll get about 16 models are there. I'm not getting it here. That's pakka income tax discussion. But just be aware, these are all called as associated enterprise. We are discussing of an associated enterprise transaction where the supplier is located in outside India. So for us, there should be a transaction between AE, And the AE, mean that the associated enterprise should be located outside India. Google India Private Limited imports some services from Google Inc. Could be a transaction. Microsoft India Private Limited gets some services from Microsoft Inc. Could be a transaction. Freshworks India Private Limited get some services from Freshworks PTE Limited, a Singapore company. Maybe a transaction covered here. So carefully, if you coin the term, there is an associated enterprise. That associated enterprise is located outside India. And that associated enterprise located outside India provides some services to, an entity in India. Nothing great. The entity in India is liable to pay tax as import of service. When? Date of entry in the books of accounts of the recipient or date of payment of this to whichever is earlier. That is to say, section 13.3e, normally we read what? Date of payment or 61st day immediately following date of invoice. In case of associated enterprise, we go one step forward. Day in which entry made. Entry, payment, or 61st day. Of this three, whichever is what? Earlier. Which will come first? Date of entry will come first. 61 days and all, they will not. Once invoice comes from my holding company, I will immediately book. Because here I should show payable, there I should show receivable. And counter should match, and that will be removed as part of their consolidation. So all that will be there. But the moment I pass entry, it triggers and hits me. My time of supply is the day in which entry made. Understand? Two coined aspects. It should be an associated enterprise. Transaction has to be import of service, because then only other party located outside India, one more person in India, means it should be only import of service. There cannot be any other reason. Sir, import of goods. Import of goods means customs law will come. Here we will not be bothered about it. We are exclusively discussing a proviso on 13.3. Then it has to be only import of service. In case of import of service, remember one more. Be little cautious. Be little agile when you see the transaction. Akbar Travels Inc. providing services to Akbar Travels India Private Limited. Bulk should flow. Proviso. I will not bother about the date of payment. First, I will see when transaction is recorded. Transaction recorded in the books of account day 5 of a month. Payment made on day 12. Invoice was issued on previous month, let's say 10th. Day in which entry made. Entry made will become time of supply. Voucher. Time of supply of voucher, no change in our understanding, be it a service also. If in services, if supply is identified, date of issue of voucher is time of supply. If in service, if it is going to be a supply not identified, then date of redemption of voucher. But let me remind you, in service industry, this voucher concept is rare and rarest. Only a few organizations operate on this voucher model. That too, all are high-end retail, high-end spa saloons operate this model. But for them, I have never come across voucher-based activities. Okay. But when it comes to voucher, when supply is not at all identified, no issues over. Same in case of additional consideration in a service transaction. A telecom postpaid bill is issued by the telecom authority, telecom company. Pay this bill before the due date. 600 rupees. If you pay the bill after the due date, 650 rupees. That 50 rupees is what? Penalty, late fee. Now, when I raise the invoice, I will not know whether my customer will pay within 30 days or he will pay between 30 to 40 days. If he pays 30 to 40 days, I'll get that 50 extra. Then my time of supply would be the day in which I receive that penalty. Same logic. In case a fraudulent transaction, both the fellow, supplier and recipient, not recorded in it, somehow government has stepped in and identified the transaction. Very simple, possible. Date on which periodical return to be filed that day or the day in which you voluntarily accept and pay the tax. That would become your time of supply. So government is very, very clear when it comes to fraudulent transactions would be part of GST. If somebody does fraud, time of supply is determinable. Which month the transaction relates? Somebody did some services, I would know. If I don't know, that year, March month, that's all. I'm just giving you a logic, best judgment. If I know it is April 2020, I'll use April 2020. If I don't know, this is an income earned during 2021. If I conclude, March 21, what is your due date? Next month, 20th, April 20th, 21 is going to be your due date. That day will become what? Time of supply. If the other fellow accepts, no, sir, correct. Fraud I did once. Pardon me. Purify me. Do all this act. Go ahead, pay the tax. Maybe the day in which he pay the tax, that day becomes time of supply. So there is no issue when it comes to fraudulent, identifying a fraudulent transaction or other transactions. So those are all the discussions relating to time of supply of goods and time of supply of services. So coming back here, that sums up our discussion relating to time of supply of goods and time of supply of services. In nutshell, when we go back, to our original discussions. When it comes to gender, time of supply, general category would be date of invoice, provided the invoice is issued within the statutory time limit, or date of receipt of payment. Of these two, whichever is earlier is going to be time of supply. A very carefully coined transaction in case of a general category where generally date of issue of invoice or date of receipt of payment, of these two, whichever is earlier, we will say. But ensure that invoice is issued within the statutory time limit prescribed. What is my statutory time limit? We will get into section 31. It will take us to 31.1. 31.1 would come out and say whenever goods are removed, invoice has to be raised. Whenever goods are made available, invoice has to be raised. Before that itself, we have raised, sir, comfortable. On that day, we have raised, sir, comfortable. We have raised afterwards, sir, then date of invoice. Then statutory limited. That day will be the day for the purpose of comparisons. Followed by in case of time of supply of goods, in case of RCM. Date of receipt of goods or date of payment to supplier or 31st day from date of invoice issued by supplier. 31st day from date of invoice. Of these three, whichever is earlier. So when it comes to your RCM related transactions, in RCM goods, date of receipt of goods, take each transaction, date of receipt of goods, date of payment to supplier, or 31st day from date of invoice. Of these three, whichever is earlier is going to be time of supply. In case of voucher, if supply is identified, date of issue of voucher. Or in case supply is not identified, then date of redemption. In case of additional consideration like small interest, penalty, late fee, date of receipt of additional consideration. In all other cases, in general, others category, which will be date of due date of return or date of payment of tax. If you could able to take grip on all these 5-6 words, I think we are done with time of supply for goods. Absolutely beyond this, nothing you have. This is what is time of supply for goods you have in store. When it comes to services, when it comes to services, Just a minute. Time of supply of service in case of general time of supply of service in case of general will be date of invoice or date of receipt of payment of these two, whichever is earlier. No doubt that invoice has to be issued within the statutory time limit. A statutory time limit is there. Within that statutory time limit, if that invoice is issued, then yes, it would be more than. In case of time of supply of services, RCM, it would be date of payment to supplier or 61st day from your date of invoice, that is date immediately following 60 days, that is means technically 61st day. Of these two, whichever is earlier. However, in case of associated enterprise, AE associated enterprise, date of entry in books of accounts or date of payment to supplier should also be considered. That is not applicable for all. Only in case of AE, only in case of AE, this condition would be applicable. When it comes to time of supply of service for voucher or additional consideration and others, for all this, same as time of supply. All the same as time of supply. This is the easiest way someone can conclude, and I have concluded in that way. The idea is, at one go, we should have a complete revision for all this. If we would able to see through this presentation, we should be able to. So that sums up your discussion relating to time of supply of goods, time of supply of services. Last part of our today's discussion, which will be more on change in rate of tax. What do we mean by change in rate of tax? When I am supplying the goods, or when I have supplied the goods, the rate of tax, let me repeat it, the rate of tax is different. When I raise the invoice, my rate of tax is different. This will not happen every day. Exceptionally, it will happen. Exceptionally, why it happens? Date of supply of services and date of issue of invoice for supply of services enjoy a statutory time limit difference of 30 days. Within that 30 days, government might change the rate of tax. When I am supplying the services, when I supply and completed my services, my rate of tax is 12%. By the time I am about to raise invoice, the rate became 18%. When I supplied the services, it was 12%. When I raised the invoice, it was 12%. But when I received the payment, at the time it became 18% possible. And you can now play on this combination. I supplied the goods, I received the payment. At that time it was 5%. But when I raised invoice, the rate became to 12%. Change in rate of tax. How to handle the transition period? It will not long last and all. 1 week, 1.5 weeks, maximum 2 weeks, that's all. The transition period, how it has to be. A question comes from Gopika. Is 61st day of invoice is applicable for AE? No doubt applicable. But understand, Gopika, first you will make the entry in the books, you know. So the moment you make an entry in the books, that will take lead. First entry will come, then payment. If payment is not done only 61st day, the moment you made an entry in the books, then that would be the earliest date. Without making entry, holding it for 61 days is not proper. Let me repeat. From an accounting perspective, it is not proper. Today, if you received an invoice, today it has to be accounted. Today you received an AE invoice, today it has to be accounted. So the moment you account it, that becomes your time of supply of service. There is no concept of 61 days. In the way in which the question is worded, if I need to think, today invoice will come. I will not account it in my books of account. I'll keep it idle for the next maybe 80, 85 days. 85th day when I make payment, I'll account invoice. No, that is not a proper accounting. Accounting is the moment you receive invoice, maybe 1 day, 2 day for processing. Certain organization takes up 4 to 5 days. Within that 4 or 5 days, it should get into the system. That is what is called as transaction recording. That is what is called as. Otherwise, every desk will have bunch of invoices on which nothing has happened. So, in a logical organization, you will have an entry of invoice, mean entry in the books of account is first. So, for a AE, 61 days is rarest applicable. It is applicable, but it is rare, I am saying. When something is added as a proviso, which means it's an additional condition to be satisfied. So in no way it dilutes the main condition. Additionally, for an associated enterprise, I have one more condition, which is day in which entry made, date of payment, 61st day from invoice, of this three, whichever is earlier. You can also reword it like that when it comes to AE. So it can also be taken that. Coming out from that question, getting into the changes in rate of tax discussion. As far as change in rate of tax, this specific discussion is concerned. It's a game of three. Why we call it as a game of three? In any case, there is going to be only three events. Supply of goods or service, date of issue of invoice, date of receipt of payment. Among these three, the whole game will flow. You will have 3 into 2 because before change in rate of tax, after change in rate of tax. Invoice before, payment and supply after. Supply before, invoice and payment after. Invoice and supply before, payment after. Vice versa. Supply after, invoice and payment before. Invoice before, supply and payment after. The game, if day three, three, four, two, three, in order, kadasi combination. Payment before, invoice and supply after. End of the day, 6 alternatives. Section 14, exclusive section. Overrides 12 and 13. First thing we need to learn there in section 13, 14 is that only. This section overrides section 12 and 13. whenever there is a change in rate of tax, 12 to 18, 5 to 12, when you see the question, it will have dates and all, invoice date, payment date. Just to see the question. On the date of invoice, 12%. On the date of payment, 18%. When you see the change in the rate, it should strike to you, it is not a question on 12 and 13, it is a question on 14. The moment there is a change in rate of tax, then it starts like this. When is your supply done? So supply done when it is at a old rate. Supply is before, so old rate. When you received invoice, after, sir. When you received a payment, after, sir. New rate. Okay. Old, new. Which I have to select? New rate. 2/3 rule, ancient model. Of the three transaction, wherever two transaction follow, that rate will be applicable. Next entry. Supply before, invoice before, payment after. Where two entry has fallen? Old. Check the rate. Old. Supply before, payment before, invoice after. What? Old rate. Invoice before, supply and payment after. To this side, new rate. Invoice and payment before, supply after, old rate. Payment before, supply and invoice after, new rate. That would sum up our discussion relating to change in rate. 2/3 rule, a very famous rule. Don't write in exam 2/3 rule alone. Okay, don't write that word. See through the question. Invoice is before change in rate of tax. Supply is before change in rate of tax. Payment received is after change in rate of tax. Hence, for the said transaction, as per section 14, the rate applicable is old rate. Invoice before, supply before, payment after. Invoice before, supply before, payment after. Old. Payment is before, invoice and supply afterwards. Another alternate question. New rate. Why two transactions here? You should not write. When you write, you will write like this, referring to section 14. Sir, do I need to remember subsection, sir? You have 14.1 ABC, 14.2 ABC. Section 14 is sufficient. That sums up our discussion for the day relating to your time of supply. I thought I should take it up this topic. So that leaves us with almost a major completion of your part A area on the introductory aspects and many areas. Leaving behind two important areas. One is valuation. Maybe about 6 hours of discussions we will have maximum, including practical problem, which we will do. 2 or 3, followed by input tax credit, which will be another sizable discussion. Okay. But for this, all the other aspects are concerned. That once that both are getting over, we would. So that sums up our discussion. So any doubts? Yes, I am ready to take it up. If you have anything, yes, we would take it up. Otherwise, I thank you all for an effective and patient listening. Thank you.